Hello everyone, so today's video is going to be like a review about this lens, the Sigma 10 20mm lens. It's like a 1 year review because I got this lens 1 year ago. So today I'm going to talk about my experience in using this lens in the last year. I am going to talk about what I like the most in this lens and what I don't like. And I will go to show you my best photos using this lens, or the photo that I like the most, which I took obviously with this lens. Now the funny part is that none of these photos is taken with this lens, but don't worry, you will see all the photos that I like and which I made from this lens. So if you are not new to this channel, or if you were searching for this lens lately, it's maybe possible that you watched my last videos talking about this lens. But it was not like a review, it was my first time ever trying to use this lens. I took my first photos using this lens in front of you. So today's video is going to be like a deeper look about this lens, because now I have experience 1 year using it. So now I have more information and I hope I can help you deciding getting this lens or not. So I will start at the beginning with what I like the most about this lens, or in this lens. It's obviously the focal length, because it starts at 10mm on my crop frame, the Nikon D90. It's something like 15mm on full frame, so it's ultra wide angle length. And if you are like me, I haven't ever tried less than 18mm before getting this lens. So at the beginning, before getting this lens, I was saying between 10 and 18mm is not a very big, you know, a very big difference between 10 and 18mm. I was saying that, but after I got this lens and I saw the scene, or the ultra wide, or the wide scene in front of me on the viewfinder of the camera, I was really amazed. I didn't expect to have this big difference between the 18mm and the 10mm. Before getting this lens, I was always, I would say 90% I was making always panoramas. But after getting this lens, I haven't ever felt that I want to make a panorama, because as I was using the 18mm lens, I was feel that the scene in front of me, I can't cover everything I want with the 18mm lens. And that's why I was always trying to make the camera vertical, horizontal. Exactly, I was trying to make the camera vertical like that, and to take sometimes, for example, 3 or 4 photos, and also 3 or 4 photos like that. So sometimes I take, for example, 4 or 3 photos and 3 photos with the 18mm lens. But after I got this lens, I haven't ever felt that I want to make a panorama. I mean, what this lens covers with the 10mm is more than enough, and you don't feel at all that you want to make any panorama. So the second thing I want to talk about today is the sharpness and the f-stop of this lens. So let's start with the f-stop at the beginning. As you may know, this lens, the f-stop of this lens is 4 to 5.6, which means I can't call it a fast lens. Fast lens, for example, like the 50mm lens, 1.8, or I think at least 2.8 to be able to call it a fast lens. But this lens is not a fast lens, which I don't care about, because if you are like me, a landscape or woodland photographer, and always on a tripod, and you don't care about having a very slow shutter speed because you are always on a tripod, and you don't care about shaky photos or something like that, then you don't have to care about not having f2.8 or something like that. So for me, f4 or f5 or f6 is no problem at all, because I am always taking photos between f9, f13, sometimes f16. Which leads me to the second part I want to talk about, which is the sharpness of this lens. Now I can say that the sharpest photos that I could make using this lens is between f9 and f16, or the best between f9 and f13. This is, I would call it, the sweet spot of this lens. I can say between f9 and f13, and the photos were totally sharp. I will show you an example right here. As you can see, this photo right here I made using this lens at 10 millimeter half a second and f13 ISO 100. So let me go to the raw file. This is the raw file after importing the photo, and this is the last editing or the last version I have. So I will go back to the raw file and I will show you this photo here, this example here, because this photo here I didn't make any focus tag. I was focusing, as I remember, I was focusing here on this tree. So let me show you the beginning of the photo, so which means this rock here, for example, or the beginning of the chair and the leaves, as you can see, is totally sharp and very good without having focus tag to be able to take a photo like that. The chair, I would say something like between five or four feet, so it's not so the closest possible to the lens. That's why I didn't make any focus tag. But as you can see here, the beginning of the photo, the leaves on the ground are sharp, and here the chair is also sharp, and here obviously the area where I was focusing, I can say that everything is sharp in the photo. So here is another example. It's taken also at 10 millimeter and 1/30 of the second f11. And here I didn't, also here in this photo, I didn't make any focus tag. Let me go back to the raw file. So here is the raw file after importing the photo, and here is after applying everything, my editing. In this photo here, I didn't also make any focus tag. That's why I'm showing you this photo, because there's no focus tag, and to be able to show you the sharpness of this lens. So as I said, I am at f11 and I was focusing on the branch itself here and not on the background. And the branch, it was, as I remember, it was something like 1 meter or something like that. So it's not, also it's not the closest possible. So as you can see here, also the background is sharp and everything looks good. And the branch also, where I was focusing, obviously is totally sharp and good. Here is also another example. This photo I took during the first video ever, which I was talking about. I went outside and I tried my first photos ever using this lens. But in this photo here, I made focus tag. And as you can see, obviously, this is not the raw file, because I made some adjustments and I make focus tag. And after that, I made also another adjustment. So what I want to talk about is that these rocks here at the beginning was the closest possible to the lens, which means something like 25 centimeter or something like 1 feet. So that's why it was not possible to take, for example, focusing at this rock here, or focusing at this rock, or focusing on the background, and to have everything sharp. That's why I made focus tag, to make sure that everything sharp from the beginning, the closest possible to the lens, all the way to the background. As you have just seen, if you are like me, landscape photographer or woodland photographer, always on a tripod, you are going to use this lens between f9 and f16, f13 for example. You can be sure that you will be able to have sharp photos, because as I wanted to get this lens 1 year ago, I found a lot of articles or a lot of videos on YouTube saying that this lens is so soft at f5 or f4, but I didn't care about that, because I knew that I will use it only at f9, f13. As you have just seen, the photos that at f9 and f13, f11, all of them are totally sharp and totally good. Another thing I like about this lens is the focus distance. It starts at 24 centimeter, which means I can have a lot of distortion. And I think this is one of the biggest benefits of using ultra wide angle lens, is that you can have a very big distortion, which means you can put a small subject at the beginning of the, or at the closest focus distance, which is the 24 centimeter. You can have a small subject, but in the picture it will look like very big because of the distortion of the lens. I will show you this example here. As you can see, this photo right here, I made focus tag in this photo here because this leaf, the beginning of this leaf, was the closest possible to the lens, which means the 24 centimeter. Now if you look to this leaf, you feel that it's very big, and it's actually bigger than the other leaf, but I can tell you that this leaf is exactly the size of this leaf here in the background. The difference is that this leaf here is a little bit far away from the lens, but this leaf is exactly at the beginning or at the closest possible to the lens. So this is what I found fantastic at using ultra wide angle lens, is that you can have something in the foreground and it will look bigger than the real life. Here is another example. These small rocks are exactly like my fingers. I was using my fingers to put them in the lake. They are so small, but if you saw the photo without watching the video, you may think that you can step on these rocks because they are exactly at the beginning of the lens, and because of the distortion in the photo they look bigger than real life, and you may feel that you can step on them, or you may feel that they are at, for example, the size of the hand, at least the size of the hand and not the size of the finger. So the last thing I want to talk about today, which I don't like unfortunately in this lens, is the chromatic aberration. Now, if you don't know what is chromatic aberration, is this thing. So the chromatic aberration happens always when you are taking a photo and the light is coming behind the subject. Like this photo here, for example, as you can see, the light is coming behind the leaves of the trees. And that's why, as you can see, all the edge of the photo, which is taken with this lens, all the edge of the photo is full of chromatic aberration, unfortunately. And even if I want to remove them in Lightroom or in Photoshop, as you can see, the photo will look like that, which means if you want to zoom to this area here, as you can see, you can obviously see that the edge of the leaves is totally bad. And if you want to print your photo, for example, if you want to print your photo big, the edge of the leaves will look totally bad. I think for me this is the only downside of this lens, the chromatic aberration. It's so hard and you can't handle it, and it doesn't always happen. For example, in these photos here I don't have chromatic aberration because I don't have a subject which the light is hitting from behind. These three photos and this photo also here, I don't have any chromatic aberration. But whenever you are taking a photo of trees and the light is coming behind the trees, you will have a lot of chromatic aberration, unfortunately, and you can't edit them using this lens. Some of you may say this is an ultra wide angle lens, start at 10 mm and not like the other lens, 18 mm, and that's why may have more chromatic aberration at the edge of the photo. I can agree with you, but I'm telling you about the thing that I don't like about this lens and the thing that may push me to change this lens in the future. And what I am sure about, that more expensive lenses, you know, or more professional lenses don't have this huge amount of chromatic aberration at the edge of the photo. So this is everything I wanted to say about this lens. I hope you found this video helpful. I hope it may help you in making your last decision about this lens. Thank you very much for watching this video. Please consider subscribing if you are not already, and see you in the next video. Bye.